Hallelujah.
So to kind of piggyback on what we've been learning for the past month, the prophetic focus for this month, you know, Pastor sought the face of the Lord, and the Lord gave him a focus that we ought to focus on this month, and it is planning with God for the year 2025. And Pastor made us understand that in corporate, when for those who work in corporations and industries, they start planning in the middle of the year. They start planning all the way in June, in July. But we in the kingdom, we don't apply those things because we just, you know, we walk by faith and not by sight. Yes, but God is also a God of order. Hallelujah. So God, Pastor, you know, was given the word to encourage us to start planning our 2025. Because if we want to see something different, then we have to take a different approach. But today, our focus will be on failure-proofing your plans. Last week, Pastor told us that we should go home and sit with our spouses and come up with a plan for the year 2024. And or come up with a personal plan for yourself. What is it that you believe God wants you to do in the year 2024? If you know it, it's not good enough that it's a knowing. It has to be written down. So Pastor told us that we should write it down. We should come up, like, what is it that we want to achieve in the year 2024? What is it that we want to press into in our purpose? So we wrote that down. I wrote that down. I wrote for each and every one of my child. And I said, this is what I want to have them focused on this year. This is what I want to focus on this year. I have a spreadsheet on my computer, and I wrote all of that down so that we are not approaching the year blindly. You know, a blind man cannot see where he's going. But when you have a goal, Pastor said, if somebody comes and drags you and say, hey, come here, you're like, no, I got something I'm working on. No, don't put me on that vehicle, because I'm on this vehicle, and this vehicle is hidden somewhere. Right? So that's the power of planning. But now we have to understand today, and the goal for this teaching today is how to failure-proof a plan. Right? Because we know that while we are planning as children of God, the enemy is also planning. Right? The Bible says that we do not wrestle against flesh and blood, but against powers and principalities. And once they see that we have a plan, they always want to use what? Distraction, right? Envy, sin, to distract us from the path at which we are going. But how can we failure-proof our plan? No man goes to war and goes and stay in front of the wall where the bullets are coming and say, yes, I am the child of God. If you're a child of God, you meet God early. If you don't wear a bulletproof, right? You're gonna be with the Lord, like there. You know? But it is wisdom that you wear a bulletproof in order to be able to withstand the wiles of the enemy. The Bible says, put on the whole armor of God. That's our bulletproof. To be able to withstand the arrows of the enemy, because they be shooting. Right? But when you put on the whole armor of God, you're shielded. Hallelujah. So today, we want to see what armor are we ought to put on our businesses, on our plans, on God's purpose and visions for our life, to ensure that the enemy does not steal it away from us. Because the enemy is a thief. Even when he's not trying to steal, he's stealing. Because when somebody is a thief, he's by his character, even when he's trying to be truthful, he's stealing. Hallelujah. So how do we failure-proof our plans? Hallelujah. So some of the things I'm just going to share, and I'm from the book of Luke chapter 14, verses 25 to 33. Luke chapter 14, 25 to 33. Hallelujah. The Bible says, and this is our core scripture, it says, and there went great multitude with him, and he turned and said unto them, let's read together. If a man come to me and hate not his father and mother and wife and children and brethren and sister, yea, and his own life also, he cannot be my disciple. And whosoever doth not bear his cross and come after me cannot be my disciple. This is Jesus speaking. For which of you, intending to build a tower, sitteth down first and counteth the cost, whether he have sufficient to finish it? Lest, happily, after he had laid the foundation and is not able to finish it, all that behold it begins to mock him, saying, this man began to build and was not able to finish. Oh, thank you. Yeah. Or what king, going to make war against another king, sitted not down first and consulted whether he'd be able with 10,000 to meet him that cometh against him with 20,000? Or else, while the other is yet a great way off, he sendeth an embassage and desired conditions of peace. So likewise, so Jesus was given a scenario on how he was using earthly things to explain heavenly phenomena, right? A parable is when you use an earthly thing to communicate a spiritual phenomenon. And Jesus was saying that which king would go to war and not count the cost of war? Who will embark on a journey to build and not count the cost of what it will cost to build a building? And so Jesus says, so likewise, whosoever he be of you that forsaketh not all that he hath, he cannot be my disciple. Jesus explained the power of counting cost. What would it cost you to be successful? Some people say, I gotta be thirsty for it. Being thirsty for it is desperate for it. And the devil is sitting in desperation. Because in desperation, he's gonna give you options that look good. And you're gonna pick. But you're gonna pick out of, anytime you pick out of desperation, you're picking out of the will of God. Because God, we are sons and daughters of kings. Just like he was sharing, I was like, he's about to preach my sermon, but Lord Jesus, right? Because when we pick out of desperation, we are led by emotions. But when we pick out of faith, we are led by the Spirit. The Bible says those who are led by the Spirit of God are the sons of God. So Jesus was telling them here that if you would be my disciple, somebody who follows my teaching, my replica, you have to count the cost of followership. And that's why today, I want to ask you, are you a child of God? Are you a disciple of Jesus? Because if you are not a disciple of Jesus, if you're not a child of God, if you haven't given your heart to the Lord, everything that I will mention here will not make sense to you. Because spiritually, you are not in alignment. So today, are you a child of God? Because if God is going to do something with you, and for his purpose, for his vision, you have to be in alignment with him. The power of faith to failure-proof your plan. No, this is the second part. Hallelujah. Amen. So our teaching series has been, we've dealt a lot with how to plan. But today I want to challenge us. Are you a child of God? Hallelujah. While planning with God for the year 2025, we must understand that God is the God of order. God is the God of order and principles and policies. He has rules. The rules are not to make us fail. They are to make us know the pulse of him, his personality, his person, how he likes to do what he likes to do, right? If somebody comes to your house, you want to tell them how you run your house, right? So they don't come here running anyhow. So the rules, the policies, the order, the commandment of God is to help us to know his person, his personality. So when we don't follow his commandment and we are his children, we contradict what we believe. We contradict what we stand for. If you don't know his rules, his wills, his ways, his policies, and you say you're a child of God and you're not doing what he does or what he's told you to do, it's contradictory. Let's imagine you start a business, you go into a company, right? The first thing they do orientation. What that means? They're trying to tell you who they are, what they do, how they do what they do. And they tell you, if you don't follow what we do, we're going to what? Fire you. But before we fire you, we're going to reorient you to what we do, how we do, and what we do, and why we do what we do. then they fire you. Why? Because they've told you their policy. The policy of God are His ways. The policy of God are His laws. The policy of God are His commandments. And if you must benefit from God, what is in God, you have to stay in alignment with His ways, with His rules, with His part. It is not to grieve you. It is to let you know who He is so that we can become like Him. Hallelujah. So that's why we must plan, because God is the God of order. Hallelujah. Are we being blessed tonight or this morning? To failure proof your plan, we can define that, right, as a measure that you put in place in order to ensure that your plan for 2025 comes to fruition. You are failure proofing it to make sure that all the things that you plan to do or that God has put in your heart to do comes to pass. Because if we fail to plan, we will plan to fail. If we fail to plan, we plan to fail. Nothing just happens by accident. Things happen when we plan. Hallelujah. Those who live their lives to chances do not have a chance. If you just live your life to like, oh, whatever will be, what's going to be is going to be. Amen? So if you live your life to, let's go with the flow, you're going to be gone with the flow. Amen? It sounds funny, but the flow just go. You're not going to know what flow is going to come and get you. But every flow will be coming at you. You will not know which one. But when you have a set flow, when you have a plan, you will not go with the flow. You'll be like, nah. I always tell my clients, no is a complete statement. When I say no, I mean no. No, why? No, I'm not telling you why. I mean no. Because sometimes when things come to challenge the plan that you have, to draw you, to be a distraction, when you tell somebody, no, I'm not going to that party. No, I'm not going to drink. No, I'm not going to that place you want me to, because I know how it be. No is what? No. No, I'm not going to explain to you why I said no. I just don't want to go. Amen? So in 2025, you must learn to say no. No to the things you don't want. You must be in control of what God has put in your hands. Hallelujah. Because those who live their lives to chances do not have a chance. In the scripture we read in Luke chapter 14, verses 25, which we read in the 28th verse while I was preparing, Jesus said, which one of you intend to build a tower and does not sit down first to count the cost, whether he has enough to finish it? And while the Lord started expanding what it means to count the cost, I want you to turn to your neighbor and tell your neighbor, you don't need money to walk in the will of God. You don't need money to fulfill God's vision for your life. Because the Bible said, the gift of a man maketh room for him. You don't need money to plan. In fact, if you begin to plan, there's a place you will plan to that you will know that what you have in your bank account is nothing compared to where you're going. Right? So do you need money to plan? No. You need the Spirit of God to help you to plan. And as you take the first step, there is vision, there is provision. There's vision, there's provision. Before you know it, you have what you need. But if you're waiting for that million, you're going to be waiting. You'll be waiting. I mean, you'll be comfortably waiting. Hallelujah. Then after you've waited for a while, you realize you're old. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. So the Lord began to expand to me and said, what it means to count the cost, it doesn't mean that you should have the cost. It just means that you should itemize what you know will be needed for success for that vision. Itemize what will be needed for the vision to become a reality. God does not need money to fulfill your vision. God did not create money. Money was created by man. The currency of heaven is not money, it's glory. That's why the Bible says, as we behold him as in the glass, we are transformed for one image. As we behold his glory. Glory is the currency of heaven. When you behold God, he begins to give you ideas. When you begin to walk out the idea, money begins to show up. So as a child of God, that's why I asked you, the first thing I asked you, are you a child of God? Because if you're looking for me to tell you how to borrow money in the bank, now God can lead you to borrow money in the bank, don't get me wrong. But what I'm saying is that if God does not lead you in that direction, he's not there with you. Whatever happens after that, that's on you. Don't say, well, God, you saw me. Yes, he saw you, but you made that decision. That was not his decision. Hallelujah. So you don't need money to afford your vision. All you just need is glory. Hallelujah. In the book of Psalms 50, verses 10 to 12. Psalm 50, verses 10 to 12. This is David telling us about how wealthy our God is. Now, if you're not a child of God, I'm sorry, you're poor. That's it. But if you're a child of God, this is for you. For every animal of the forest is mine, says the Lord, and the cattle on a thousand hills. I know every bird in the mountains, and the insects in the fields are mine. If I were hungry, I would not tell you, for the world is mine, and all that is in it. So this is God telling you that I got everything you see is mine. But in order to access it, you have to be in alignment with me and what I've called you to do. You have to be in alignment with what I've called you to do. God wants us to plan with him. He wants to put kingdom dreams in our hands. Everything God puts in our hands has the ability to make money. Because some people think that when you follow God's will, you're not going to make money off of it. If God says that everything that is on this earth is his and you are a child of God, can you prove to me how those things, you don't have an inheritance in them? You do. But the devil has made us think less of our identity in God so that we do not access what is ours. But today I've come to tell you that everything in this earth, according to his will for your life, is yours. But you must align yourself with him. You can't be playing church. You got to play relationship now. Because playing church will not yield you anything. You got to play relationship with the God. I seek God's face. I behold his glory every day. Because when I behold his glory, remember, glory is the money you need to transact. Glory is not church. It's glory. How do you behold his glory? You spend time with him. You commune with him. You expose yourself to him. If he tells you don't do something, don't do it. If he tells you do something, that's what you do. Hallelujah. Praise the name of the Lord. So God wants to put kingdom dreams in our hands. He wants to help us to make money, to generate money from the dreams that he puts in our hands. When you dream kingdom dreams, and you partner with God for his will here on earth, everything that you do will become a success. Everything that you do. Have you ever seen somebody that, you know, everything that they do is like they're cruising through life and you're wondering what happened to me? And they're following God wholeheartedly. That's because that's a place that you can be too. If you make a decision in your heart to follow God all the way, God is responsible for you. And he's not an irresponsible father. He don't leave his kids at the face of a war. He does not leave them when they need him the most. God is a responsible father. He's responsible for every of his child. Hallelujah. The Bible says in Matthew 6, 31 to 33. Matthew 6, 31 to 33. Brother Mo kind of spoke about that a little bit this morning. But it says that when your plan and goal connects to the kingdom of God, God is committed to ensuring the delivery of your plan. It says, therefore, do not worry, saying, what shall we eat? What shall we drink? Or what shall we wear? For after all these things, the Gentiles are the unbelievers. That's what they seek. what shall we eat, what kind of car, what kind of, you know, house. I want a Lamborghini, Louis Vuitton, all that stuff. That's what the Gentiles, that's what they think about. But here he says, for your heavenly Father knows that you need all these. He knows that you wanna be in that nice house. Amen. He knows that that car, there's a car that I really want. Amen. But I'm seeking the kingdom of God first, because I know in the end I'm gonna be in that car. Y'all gonna say, amen, in the name of Jesus. But I'm seeking the kingdom of God first, because I understand what is priority. The kingdom of God is priority, because every other thing will be added unto me. But he says, yeah, but seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness. Be in right standing with him, and all these things that you desire shall be added unto you. When you plan the kingdom plan, when you have a kingdom plan, you will see that all these things will be added unto you. What is the kingdom plan? Is whatever plan that God has put in your heart, that he gets to get the glory. That's a kingdom plan. If you, like a barbershop, how are you giving glory in the barbershop? Pray over your client, praying over their head. Amen? Their destiny. Praying over them. What other businesses? Praying over your home. Every home that everyone comes, if you have a home and people come into the house, you put the blood of Jesus as a sign on the house that anyone who comes here, they will receive their deliverance. You speak that into existence. In your vehicle, everything you lay your hands shall prosper. That when you touch somebody's car, it's not only going to be fixed, but if it goes bad, because you know, things of this earth will always go bad after all, right? It cannot last forever. And transportation. You know that as you go, as you carry people in your vehicle, they will have an encounter with the Lord. That the presence of the Lord that you carry on the inside will radiate on them. Right? That on transportation, when you lay your hands on the car, it will go well. The people who enter the car, after you enter the car, they will say, oh, something happened. Somebody, don't worry about that. Somebody came here, got into my car, and I just felt peace when I came in the car. That's because of what you carry. But if you don't carry it, you cannot give it. If you don't carry the presence of God, you cannot give it. All you're going to be saying is theory. Oh, God is good. Yeah, we know. We've been known. That's what they told us when we were young. But carry the presence of the Lord. Because that's how you can prove failure. Proof your business. One of the key principles, and I'm going to run through it very quickly because I know time is not on our side. One of the key principles on how to failure proof your plans and your vision for the year 2024 or 2025 is, one, you must access the power of faith. You need to believe God that what he says he will do, he will do. You need to believe that God is not a liar. That if he tells you, if he puts it in your heart, he's able to bring it to pass. The Bible says God is not a man that will lie. God is not like us. Sometimes we say what we're going to do and we don't do it. God does not say what he's not going to do. If he tells you, he's going to do it. If he says it, it will come to pass. So you got to believe it. But if you don't believe it, God will not enforce himself on you. God is not going to be begging you, oh, please believe me. Please, just believe me. You got to believe him in your heart. You have to make a decision to believe him, to trust in him. In Matthew 19:26. Hallelujah. Matthew 19:26 says, but Jesus beheld them and he said unto them, with men this is impossible, but with God, all things, not some things, not a few things, all things are possible. But when you stand in faith, you know, the Bible says that if a man is going to stand, and I'm paraphrasing, if a man is going to stand in faith, he cannot be wavering. You cannot be today, I believe, tomorrow, I don't believe, today, I believe. He says, let that man not think that he will receive anything from the Lord. He says, when you go back and forth on your faith, he said, don't expect anything from the Lord. Because you're not, You're not giving him the right signal. Today you say, oh yeah, I believe you. Tomorrow you say, I don't believe. Then God's like, how do I move? I don't know. Should I send my angels? Should I not send them? It's confusing. But if you stand in faith, not wavering, your plans will be secured. Hallelujah. In the book of Hebrews 11:11, I love this scripture so much. It says, now, faith is a substance of things hoped for. You know what a substance means? A substance means something you can grab onto. It's a tangible thing. It's something you believe in. Now, faith is a substance. Money is a substance too. A bag is a substance. A shoe is a substance. A shirt is a substance. Faith is a substance, something you can hold on to. It's a substance of the things that you hope in your heart. The evidence of the things that you cannot see. You hoped for the barbershop before he came. Didn't you hope for it? You dreamt about it. You imagined yourself in it. You saw yourself in it. You saw yourself in front of the door like this. Right? In the picture, like, that's my stuff, right? You hoped for it. You hoped for it. So faith is a substance. Now, what is faith? That your barbershop is faith. Because that is the result of your faith. Faith is a substance. It's something that you hold on to. So what are you believing God for the year 2025? What are you believing? Have you made your plan? You must have faith about it. You must imagine yourself in it. You must see yourself in it. You must daydream about seeing yourself improving, getting the bigger shop, getting that infrastructure, getting it incorporated, getting it franchised. That is faith. That is the substance you need. Write it down and have faith, the substance. That's how you can failure-proof your vision for the year 2025. Hallelujah. The next point is the power of getting the right information and planning. In the book of Proverbs chapter 25, verses 3 to 4, Proverbs 24, verses 3 to 4, the Bible says, any enterprise is built by wise planning, becomes strong through common sense, and profit wonderfully by keeping abreast of the fact. Let's go to New King James on that scripture. Hallelujah. Can we have a New King James translation, please? Hallelujah. Lack of information is ignorance, and ignorance is costly. It says, through wisdom a house is built, and by understanding it is established. By knowledge, the rooms are filled with all precious and pleasant riches. Whatever you have planned for the year 2025, you need to seek wisdom. You need to seek knowledge on that thing. If you want to expand your business and you see that at this point, the business that I'm doing, I see that I'm lacking in knowledge on a particular area. Seek knowledge on that area. Because once you seek knowledge on that and you get proficient at it, that's growth. If you want to, you know, like myself, want to have a business, want to have a clinic, I'm learning about how to run a clinic. I'm taking courses. I'm exposing myself to the information on how to run a clinic. Why? Because that's what I desire. Because I cannot go into it ignorantly. Oh, I own something. But when you ask me a question, I can't answer you. I cannot say, oh, I want to sing so that the world will hear me. I cannot sing in front of multitude, and I'm not giving myself to training and seeking knowledge and getting a voice trainer. How do you think that's going to happen? I'm going to go sing and embarrass myself. Let's not be making Christianity look boring. Let's apply the knowledge and information that is needed in order to prosper. You have to be informed. Ignorance is costly. It's very costly. We have to apply ourselves. Hallelujah. The next point here on how to failure-proof your vision for the year 2025 is the importance of prayer. prayer is a shield. In the book of Proverbs chapter 16, verses 3. Hallelujah. Proverbs 16, verses 3. Hallelujah. Let's have that projected. Thank you. It says, commit thy works unto the Lord, and thy thoughts shall be established. Commit your works unto the Lord in prayer, and your thought shall be established. You know, commit your work. So let's take a look at that. I commit my work, everything, my what they say, grind, right? I commit it to the Lord. God, I'm going out today. You know, I'm doing what I got to do. I'm committed to my works, right? I'm going to work. I'm not being lazy, right? We commit it to the hands of the Lord. And the Bible says that our thoughts will be established. Those are two different things. God is proving you by your works. He says, show me your works by your faith, and I will show you my faith by my works. So sometimes when we are doing something and we are not consistent at it, it is a proof that we are not ready for the bigger thing. It's a proof. If you're not consistent at what God is putting in your hands now, the little things that you're doing right now, you're waiting for that big spot, that big stage, that big business so you can feel almighty. But you're not committed to the little thing that God has put in your hands, He cannot establish you. That's what this scripture says. Commit your works, the things that you're doing, how you're showing up, how you're doing what you got to do. And the Bible says your thoughts, your imagination, the things that you desire in your heart, your thoughts will be established. So your work is a test of what you are capable of. It's a test of your potential. It's a test of what you really can do. Because you can't do more than what you can do. You can't do more than what you're already disciplined to do. You're not going to run somebody else's business better than, or you're not going to run your business better than you will run somebody else's business. Because you will do what you know. So when you are at somebody else's job, do it well. Because it's a proof of how you're going to do yours. Hallelujah. If you do it shabbily, when God does give you yours by mercy, if He does, you're going to struggle the same struggle you are struggling right now. Because you have not developed the discipline in what you're doing now. So every of your works, commit it to the hands of the Lord. In prayer, improve on what you are doing right now. Get better at it. So that when God expounds you, you're not going to be like, God, I'm tired. I want to give up. I can't do this. How did I get here? You will not be murmuring. Because you've already committed to the discipline of now. Of what you're already doing right now. You're already advancing yourself. You are staying focused on the journey. You are improving yourself. You are getting new skills. You are acquiring new skills. So that when God will promote you on your own, you do the same thing that you did for somebody else. You can't cut corners. So to prayerly approve your plans and vision for the year 2025, you must do that in prayer. Committing your works. Praying about it. Committing your works, asking God for strength to help you to improve yourself at what you are doing now in order to bring forth your own. Hallelujah. In the book of James chapter 5, 17 to 18, we see a man who prayed, who committed his heart's desire in the hands of the Lord. And this is what happened. In James 5, 17 to 18, the Bible says about Elijah, he was a man subject to passion as we are, and he prayed earnestly that it might not rain, and it rained not on the earth by the space of 3 years and 6 months. The next, and he prayed again, and the heavens gave rain, and the earth brought forth her fruit. This was, the Bible says here, that Elijah was a man like you and I. He prayed that there would be no rain. And there was no rain for 3.5 years. And the Bible says that he prayed again, and there was rain. So that means that you and I ought to engage the power of prayer to shield and protect our plans for the year 2025. Because we know, like I said, the enemy is planning, but prayer is a shield. Prayer is a shield. Hallelujah. Every time you pray, and there's this thing I hear that people do, that they say, oh, manifest whatever you manifest what you say. That's a new age religion. You don't manifest nothing. I'll tell you how you manifest it. As a child of God, as someone of the kingdom, a child of a king, there are angels at your service. Right? You have an angel. Everybody got an angel. There's an angel assigned to this church. Okay, there's an angel assigned to you. There's an angel assigned to me. Anytime we want to activate our angel, this is how you activate your angel. Yes, sir. Oh, hallelujah. Anytime you want to activate your angel, the reason why our angels don't work for us, I'll tell you how. When we are not in the spirit, they don't work for us. And when we are negative with our mouth, right? And the Lord is helping us, right? So angels are at our command, our disposal. Thank you. So anytime you want to activate your angel, you go into a time of prayer, fasting, and meditation on the word of God. You cleanse your heart. You repent of your sins. Hallelujah. And then when you begin to pray according to the will of God, the angel of the Lord is dispersed for you. That's why as a Christian, you have to stay in a life of prayer, fasting, and meditation. Because when you do that, you are connected to God. Your spirit man is connected to heaven. So when you decree a thing, your angel runs and gets it to pass. So when you are saying you are manifesting, oh, I manifest goodness. You are not manifesting anything. Because as a child of God, this is how it goes. You pray in the name of Jesus. You command your angel in the name of Jesus to do what you know is in the will of God for you to do. They go and do it. They bring it to pass. And lines are falling onto you in pleasant places. That's how it works. Angels can be invisible. They can be visible. Have you ever been in a situation where you're between a hard place and a rock? And you just say a prayer, Lord. And something just happens and changes everything. That's an angelic intervention. Amen. That is an angelic intervention. Because they work in the invisible to bring the visible to reality. So if you've not been using your angels, if you've not been commanding your angel, you are not fully maximized. You are suffering for something that your angel can do in the twinkle of an eye. I remember when the Lord showed me a vision of an angel. I saw this. I was in that dream. It was like something was coming at me. There were a lot of battle, and the Lord told me to stand up, and He gave me a mic. He said I should be singing. I started singing, and the moment I started singing, I just saw something came from the sky. It was a cross. It was a cross. Bam! It was a man. He was not even tall, you know all this, but when you touch him, he was like steel. You know when you touch an Iron Man and he don't move. He was stronger than the Iron Man. And this was walking like this. And he was ready to take command. That's what we have as children of God. We have an army that is at our disposal. Do you know that? Don't be deceived. This Christian thing is the thing. This is the thing. We got people working for us that we don't gotta pay. And they answer us immediately. So when you failure proof your plan, you need more than you. You need the angel of the Lord. You need the power of the Holy Ghost. Hallelujah. You need to do it by prayer. Prayer is the way you communicate with your angels. Say, in the name of Jesus, do this for me. In the name of Jesus, make way for me. When I go there, go before me to make ways parted. You must use your angel in the year 2025. You must use your angel because you're doing too much. You're doing too much. Ask them to go help you. I'm practicing that too. Trust me, I am practicing that. Because as human, you think we are almighty. We are not. But we have the Almighty on our side who has made available resources for us as His children. Like I said, if you're not a child of God, this is not for you. This is strange to you. You don't know it. You're not in the kingdom. It's not for you. So to failure-proof your marriage, marriage. Amen. That too, you got to failure-proof it in the name of Jesus. Amen. To failure-proof your vision and plans for the year 2025, you must pray. Pray like Elijah. Call the things that be not as though they are, and they will remain as you have said, until you say otherwise. In the name of Jesus. The other point, in order to fully approve your plan and vision for the year 2025, is to seal the mouth of the devourer. Like I told you, all of God's plan and purpose for us is to make us wealth. Is to prosper. He says, I wish above all things that you prosper and be good as your soul prospered. Because when your soul prospers, you will prosper physically. But we know that the enemy always wants to negate everything that God has done. So he puts the devourer to be alert for the children of disobedience to devour the result or the profit of our labor. Hallelujah. You have to, to fully approve your plans and vision for 2025, you have to understand the importance of tithe. Tithe. You know, the word tithe means a tenth. Listen, God is our provider. God is the source of Tola. Sometimes when I'm giving my tithe, I'm bleeding inside. You understand? Because it's quite much. Sometimes when I'm transferring the money, I say, Lord, Father, how can this be? My husband said, okay, just put it in, automated withdrawal so you don't see it. And I said, no, I want to give it every 2 weeks so that I can put and condition my heart to trust God for my provision. I said, I want to. Every time when I get paid, I say, thank you, Lord. I start transferring things where they're supposed to be. Every time I'm transferring the tithe, my heart is going like this. But I want to put myself under that suggestion so that I would take value away from money. Because, of course, when you see that money hit your account, all things are possible. Okay? anything can happen. You start distributing but buying the things that I put on the cart. Okay, on Amazon or wherever I shop, thank you. You just exposed me. It's okay. Right? I start doing this. I start spraying, but I told myself that I want to be paying it every month so that I can tell my heart, be still. Your source is not money. Because the enemy has a plan for us. You know, a tithe means a tenth of, okay, let me read what I wrote here. So tithe means a tenth, a tithe. The word originated from the Hebrew word asah, which means to tithe and to take, to tithe. In the book of Leviticus 27:30, I told you that the laws of God are his ways, are his personality. He's how he wants to show us a side of him, and he puts it into law for our understanding. So that even the mere man that does not have the Holy Spirit can know his ways. So God told Moses, here he says, and all the tithe, the tenth, the asah of the land, whether of seed of the land or of fruit of the trees, is the Lord. It is holy unto the Lord. In the book of Deuteronomy 14, verses 22, it says, God told Moses, he said, you shall, and Moses was telling the children of Israel, he said, you shall tithe all the yields of your seed that comes from the field year by year. Because the tenth of your income is a sign of your trust in the Lord as your source. I'll say that again. A tithe, a tenth of your income is a sign of your trust in the Lord as your source. Until you understand, remember I told you God did not create money. He didn't. Man created money for transaction. Hallelujah. God created glory. He lives in glory. And he gives us the ability to make wealth. So when we make the profit of our wealth, the tenth of it says, give unto me. It is a sign of your trust in me. Because in the book of Malachi, chapter 3, 8 to 12. Malachi 3, 8 to 12. You know, Malachi, a prophet Malachi, he was given a prophecy. And he was saying, will a man rob God? He said, yet you have robbed me. But he said, wherein have we robbed thee? In tithe and in offering. Keep going. Because we know these things, though. It says, because you have robbed me in tithe and in offering. He was saying as a mouthpiece of God, he was giving a prophetic declaration that ye are cursed with the curse. Meaning that God, remember when the prophet is speaking, they are speaking the mind of God. So they are speaking what God is saying. So when Malachi was speaking to them, it was God cursing them. He says, ye are cursed, for ye have robbed me, even this whole nation. Keep going. But bring ye all the tithe into the storehouse, that there may be meat in my house, and prove me now therewith, said the Lord of hosts, if I will not open the windows of heaven and pour you out a blessing, that there shall be not room enough to receive it. Amen. So in order to prove, failure proof your plans for this year 2024, you must understand the power of tithe. Like I said, tithe, it is not a donation. It is not to give to the church. By the grace of God, Pastor and I planned, before we got married, we were already paying our tithes to Tola. We were paying tithes to Tola. So when we were coming into starting church, we had money to run church. But if we don't talk about it, you would have done everything else right. But the devourer will still be attacking your plan, will still be attacking your finances, will still be attacking you. Why? Because we have not shared this heart of God with you. You must tithe. Tithe is not a free will offering. It's a position of intentionality that God, yes, you gave me the strength to make this money. And this money has come. It's not me that gave me the strength to make this money. It is you. So as a sign of understanding who my source is, I give this back to you in a trust relationship. Because it says when you do that, the Bible says, now prove me, says the Lord. Prove me if I will not open up the windows of heaven and pour you out a blessing that there shall be no room to contain it. I was reading the book, the story about J.C. Penney. I know Pastor shares that with me a lot. And today I read it and it really sunk in my soul. This man, even though J.C. Penney, the one who we know very well, you know, I love their dresses, okay? But now it's kind of a little too short, so I ain't wearing no more. No sleeve is short. You know, J.C. Penney started off, you know, as a child of a pastor. He was taught how to tithe. He started his business understanding this principle of tithing. He got so big and wealthy. Okay? So big. You know when a corporation are tithing, they're not tithing in 500, 600. It's in millions. If you're making billions, you're tithing what? In millions. And when you're writing that check, it's like you're bleeding. It's like your whole body, you're getting dissociated from your person because, oh my Lord. He got so big that tithing was not like, man, if we invest this money, we will invest this money. And suddenly, the things that made him wealth, he started disregarding it. Tithing and giving to the poor. Do you know that the devourer came and his business almost shut down? His wife left him. He lost almost everything. His children left him. He was brought almost to nothing. He was going to be admitted in a psych ward. That's what I read. And while he was in the hospital, he heard this hymn about trusting the Lord. And he realized that he had not trusted God with his finances. And the devourer came. That the things he thought he had, the devourer took it from him. And so he repented that day. He went back to church. He was baptized. And there was a restoration of everything that he lost. The principle of the kingdom are the way that God has put in place to release his blessing on us. And through tithe, it is in trust. If you trust God with your tithe, you will prosper financially. If you don't tithe financially, you may prosper otherwise, but you ain't gonna have money. And we know a lot of Christians who love the Lord, Holy Ghost speaking, Bible speaking, and they know each word by word, but they don't got money. That's because we have left the kingdom principle. You cannot invest God's money in a bank that he owns the L head. You're saying, let me take 10%, let me invest it. You cannot invest God's money. God is not an investor. He created the investor. He himself is wealth. But he is trying to check your heart to see if your God is money. Or he is your God. And if money is your God and he loves you and he wants to reconnect you back, he will take money away from you so that he can reconnect you back to him. So to failure-proof your plans for your business, tithe your business. Tithe it. As a friend, is an advice. Because I know how it is. It be too much sometimes. But if it be too much, that's God. That's because God has greater for you. When you take your focus off money, you will see wealth. When you take your focus off paycheck and holding on to finances, you will see wealth. You know, when somebody is rich, it's different. When somebody is wealthy, it's different. That's a kingdom principle that we must understand so that we can see the hand of God over our finances. To failure, because you will need money to do certain things on this earth. But in order to keep the flow coming, you have to follow the principles of the kingdom. Now, if they're not of the kingdom of God, don't tithe. Don't tithe, because we know who your father is. Your father does not need you to tithe. He already got your soul. He gave you the money so that you can do dangerous things for him. And then at the end of the day, you will join him in hellfire. But when your father is the Lord, these are his principles. If you must prosper in him. Hallelujah. The other point is the importance of writing out your plans. Write it out. Habakkuk 2:2-3. It says, and the Lord answered me and said, write the vision. Make it plain upon the tablets. In this case, upon the paper or upon the phone, upon your note, right? We don't have tablets anymore. But write it plain on the paper, that he may run that readeth it. Write your vision. For the vision is yet for an appointed time, but at the end it shall speak, and it will not lie. Though it tarries, wait for it, because it will surely come and it will not tarry. You know, the power of writing down your plans and putting it before you is the power to, you are, when you do that, you have put yourself in a discipline of consistency. You know, concerning the business that God blessed us with, the Lord gave me a vision about a rock and water. The water was dripping on rock, dripping on rock. People didn't think that this rock was going to be cracked on this little water. The water was little. It had no force. It was just a drop. And as the water dropped over and over and over and over again, one day the rock cracked. So the power of your vision, putting it before you, is going to help you to be excited to walk towards the vision. That even if you are doing something little towards the vision, the Bible says here that in the end it will speak. That which you envision for the plan of God for your life, for the businesses that God has put in front of you, for fulfilling purpose in God, if you continue to do something towards it, If you want to grow in the things of the Spirit, put yourself on a prayer and fasting and meditation. Maybe once a week, you are fasting till 12 and you say, Lord, I'm going to put myself on this discipline because I want to grow in the things of the Spirit. You put yourself in that discipline. And before you know it, after 1 year, you will see that you have gotten closer with the Lord. Maybe you want to fast on the weekend because you work Monday to Friday on the weekend, and you are fasting and you're praying and you're meditating, you're praying in the Holy Ghost, and the Lord now begins to give you vision and begins to give you clarity. You are pressing in into God's call upon your life. That's the power of vision. If God has put something in your heart, write it down. Not only write it down, plan towards it. Put yourself on certain discipline. After 8 p.m., you know, maybe your discipline is to be able to wake up early to do something towards your business. So you tell yourself, at 8 p.m., I must be in bed. At 9, I must be sleeping so that I can wake up 5 o'clock in the morning. 1 hour before I start work, I'll have to do something towards my business. And then I go start work. If you do that over 1 year, you would have done so much towards that purpose, that plan. And you will be ending that goal, the fruition of that vision. So put yourself under discipline. Write out your plan. Make it plain. And the other point is to stay focused. Stay focused on the plan. For the year 2025, you have a plan. Stay focused on it. I'm believing God for this. This is an area of my life that I'm believing God for. And I was like, Lord, why do I have so much plan and visions and things and I'm just everywhere? You know what the Lord told me? He said, that's because you have the power and the ability to prefer solutions to a lot of people's issues. So when you have those flights of ideas, that's because you know how to help people. Write them down. Write them down. But don't let that lose your focus from what you are doing. Hallelujah. In case you are like me, I'm just sharing what the Lord told me. Maybe he will bless you. So if you have too many ideas that you want to do, when they come, just write it down. Somewhere in your phone, you know, a page of ideas. But the one that you're doing right now, finish it up. So that you can have results. You can have proof of what you have planned. Hallelujah. So focus. The Bible says in Matthew 6, verses 24. Thank you. It says, no man can serve two masters, for either he will hate the one and love the other, or he will be devoted to the one and despise the other. You cannot serve God and mammon. This just talks about the focus on God, focusing on that vision, focusing on that purpose, not being tossed to and fro. Focus on the Lord. Focus on what he has called you to do. Focus on your plan in 2025. My husband always tells me, if it's not in the plan, we are not doing it. So if you have an idea, maybe the idea is for 2026. Put it on that list. But this 2025 list that we have, we're staying focused on it. A personal plan, stay focused on your plan. Hallelujah. Is the Lord speaking to someone tonight, this morning? In the name of Jesus. Hallelujah. And then the last but not the least, how to failure proof your plan for the year 2025 is the power of getting wise counsel. We have to understand that it's not, we are not a conglomeration or a compilation of knowledge. We have to understand that there are some people that may know better than we do. There are some people that have been in the business that have been doing what we want to do. It is important that we seek wise and godly counsel. Not just talking to anybody, because again, you have to be careful not to talk to somebody who's going to discourage you or steal your dreams. However, being able to locate the right counsel, a wise counsel, and the right counsel for you is so important in order to be able to achieve your plans and your vision for the year 2025. In Proverbs chapter 15, verses 22, the Bible says, plans fail for lack of counsel, but with many advisors, they succeed. That's why as a church family, I love this family of God, because we're able to share our dreams with each other without either feeling intimidated by anybody or being discouraged by or being threatened by one's vision. When you bring your counsel into, maybe talk to, you know, pastor, he's always encouraging us to press forward. He's always pushing us to do better, to, you know, troubleshoot, you know, any kind of situation that we may be. Well, if we go to the wrong counsel, they will drift us away. So getting the right people in your circle is so important for you to be able to actualize all the plans that you have for the year 2025. These things are not rocket science. If you notice those who are who are successful, they have a group of friends that maybe they play golf with. They have a tight circle where they share ideas and bounce ideas off of. Because they understand the power of wise counsel and having a group of people that can encourage you, uplift you, strengthen you, press you and, you know, push you out of your comfort zone and say, keep moving. Keep moving. Go drop that water on your stone today. What have you done today towards your purpose? What have you done today towards your goal? Have you done something or you're just waiting for a miracle to happen? Because miracle does happen, but if you leave things to chances, you don't get a chance. You won't. The people that are prepared will take the opportunity faster than you will. But you're still waiting on God. And God is, like you said, God is waiting on you. Apply yourself. Apply yourself. Have a plan. Work towards it. Do one thing every day towards the purpose that God has put in your hands. The vision. That kingdom vision that he has put in your heart. That kingdom vision that God is going to get glory on. Do one thing towards it and see if God will not show up. Because you have to understand that God is equally interested in your vision. Because by extension, you are his light. And he is light. And through you, he wants to shine his light. So when you have a kingdom purpose, it is a partnership. You are partnering with God concerning what he wants to bring on earth. So God is equally responsible. Do one thing. Make an action towards your plan. Press in every day. When you wake up, ask yourself, have I done something towards my goal? Have I done one thing? Is it open up a bank account? Is it going sharing flyers? Is it talking to somebody that knows the business? Is it getting engaged in music training? I just started, I got a vocal coach. So, you know, the voice got to sound good. Amen. We can't be sounding like what happened. Amen. Right? If God has called you on that, I'm not going to say, oh, yeah, I can sing in church. I'm not going to get a coach. Then I go sing somewhere and they're like, like I always tell my kids, You know, I'm not going to do that because if we're striving for excellence, God is excellent. So we must strive for excellence. God is invested in our plan. He wants to be involved in our plan. He wants to get the glory. So do something towards it every day. No day should pass that you have not said, you have either not shared your vision with somebody who you know can be influential in bringing that to pass, or one day you have not done something, or whatever it may be. You know what your plan is, I don't know. But do one thing towards that goal. And at the end of 2025, you will realize that you have put yourself in a trajectory of success. You have put yourself in the lineup of people that will be successful. Because you have understood, one, that you need faith to failure-proof your plan. If you cannot believe for it, it cannot happen. If you don't believe God for it, don't expect it. God is not a magician. He will do exceedingly abundantly above all you what? Think, imagine. Things that are in your heart. He will do exceedingly abundantly above all you think or imagine according to the power of faith that is in you. He will not do it outside of the power of faith that is in you. Why? Because he's going to overwhelm you. So if you have faith for little, he will give you little. If you have faith for big and you have put yourself in the discipline to have that capacity being put on you, he will do it with you. God will not overwhelm us. But if your faith is little, he will give you according to your faith. Because if he gives you more, it's going to be an abuse. It's going to be an irritation. It's going to be too much for you to handle. You know when they give you too much job on your job and your work on your job and you're like, you're going to be all over the place. He don't want you all over the place. But the power and measure of faith that is in you is what he will give. Hallelujah. You must also understand that to failure proof your plan for the year 2025, you must get information. Don't be ignorant. Ignorance is not bliss. And don't rely on the knowledge of the old, particularly when you are in a business line that is always evolving. Get current information, because information that are not current is just as though it's no information, because it does not apply. But current information will help you to achieve your goal. The next point is the power of prayer. You must pray to failure proof your plans. Prayer is a shield. With prayer, you can call the things that be not. You can project your prayers into the future. You can project your prayer even now into your now as concerning God's plan and purposes for your life. The other point is that you must tithe. You must tithe in order to failure proof your plan and your business so that the devourer does not devour your profits. Because even Uncle Sam, he don't wait for you to give him. He takes it. The money does not get to you first and then he will be waiting. No. But when you tithe, it is a sign that you show God that you trust him, that he is your source and not the money. And tithe is a tenth of your income. You must also understand that writing down your plan in a place where you can see them is so important. Because sometimes what we see is what we imagine. Have you ever watched a movie and suddenly you are imagining yourself in the movie? You're not part of the cast. Your name ain't on the list. But how come you're seeing yourself in the movie? Because you opened your eyes to it. So when you see your plan every time and you read through it, you begin to see yourself in the future of that plan. That's why you must write them down. Write down your plan and make it plain. You must also focus on them. Not just write them down, focus on them. Focus to the point where you through this focus, you may start to lose friends. And can I tell you that's okay? No, that's okay. In fact, you don't really need much friends in your life. You don't. They can be a distraction. You need one or two people that you can be accountable to. Who can lead you in the path that you're heading to. And once you find one that is not in that same space with you, please let them go. Do yourself a favor. Protect God's plan for your life. Do your own due diligence, because sometimes your friends don't see where you're going. And it's not for them to see where you're going, because the purpose, the plan was not given to them. If devil had known that Jesus came to die, if he had known, he would not have killed him. He didn't know. So some of your friends don't know what God had put on your life. Even when you try to explain to them in words, you try to explain to them in tongues, you start to explain to them in your Facebook post, you try to explain to them in your status post, you try to explain to them like, I'm going to church on Sunday. They don't get it. They don't understand, because it's not for them to understand. Focus. Say no. And don't have to feel like you have to explain. No is the complete statement. Don't ask me why. No, I just said no, and that's okay. Don't ask me. I mean, if my children told me no, I'm going to ask them why, and they better tell me. But when they become an adult, I should be able to entrust them with some level of responsibility. So if somebody's asking you why, They're not your mama. Amen. So no is a complete statement. I don't want to do this because in regards to your purpose. Now, if you go to a mentor, somebody who is a guardian over you, and you tell them no, you need to explain why. Because you've submitted yourself to them, of course. But otherwise, every other person can get a no without an explanation. Because sometimes when you want to explain to them, you start rationalizing and telling yourself, well, you was mean. You were actually, you know, not done. You start faulting yourself for something that is right for you to do. No. No is a no. One of my clients, he was testing positive for meds and THC and all that. And he's like, well, I've been through a lot. Okay, he said, I've been through a lot, you know, I've been to jail, this, that. He was like, but I know not to do this thing, but I end up doing it. I said, why? He said, because it was just there. You know, it was just there, and I just decided to take a little bit. And I said, okay, so you've told me, you know, you've been through a lot, right? That's what I told him. I said, you've been through a lot, right? Yes, I said, so you know a lot. He said, yeah. I said, so, you know, the definition of a wise person is somebody who learns from their past mistake. Wisdom is released when knowledge has been achieved and understanding has taken place. Then you become wise. I said, so now that you know that you've been through a lot, how are you managing when you see something? When somebody comes in, sometimes I'll even roll stuff in a little ball and I'm like, yeah, take. You want that? I'm like, take it. It's good. It's going to make you feel good. I said, yeah, take it. It's going to make you feel good. And they look at me like, nah, I'm good. I don't want it. I said, no, take it. You feel good, man. You look stressed, man. You got to take that thing, right? And I acted out in front of them. They're looking at me like, who's this crazy lady who has an accent? Where's she from? You don't know where I'm from. I'm from heaven. You know, and I acted out to them. And they say, no, I don't want it. I said, the way I pushed you to take it and you didn't take it from me, the same way you say no when somebody comes and offers it to you. And he came back the next time, this past Friday, and he's like, man, I can't wait to tell you, man, I'm clean. I'm like, see, what happened? He was like, I just told him, no, I ain't about that life. I said, very good. Because no is a complete sentence. If I ain't doing it, I'm not doing it. If it's not in God's plan for my life, and I know God's plan for my life, no, I'm not doing it. And if you don't want to be my friend, that's okay. Because I don't need that much friend. I need the right people in my circle. I need godly counsel. I got, like I told you, you have God. You have angels that you cannot see. They're waiting for you to. So you're actually not alone. Then you have people who are like-minded to keep you focused on God's plan for your life. So that you don't get derailed. You don't get distracted by the people who are not going anywhere. And they want to take people with them. So stay focused. And the last but not least, get wise counsel. When you want to make big decisions in your life and you're not sure, don't make decisions out of emotions. Find somebody to talk to. Somebody who can speak life over you. Maybe somebody who can help you see things in a better perspective so that you don't do things that you would later regret. That is how you can failure-proof I don't know why I'm saying marriage. I've been listening to a lot of sermons about marriage. Hallelujah. But you failure-proof your marriage also by wise counsel. By wise counsel. People who have been married, ask them, how do you do things? Because marriage is beautiful on the outside, right? But sometimes we go through things. So maybe when you go to people who are seasoned and have wisdom, by the leading of the Holy Spirit, they can speak life into you and say, maybe this is the season of your marriage. Hallelujah. Maybe this is where you are right now, but pray to God. Hallelujah. So I just want to thank God for today, because these words also spoke to my heart as it did. But I want us to go before the Lord today. And I want us to repent in any way that maybe in the past we didn't have plans, or we had plans and we didn't have a kingdom plan. We didn't put God as the priority, as the first, I want us to go before the Lord this morning and say, Lord, I repent for not having faith. I repent for not believing that you can bring this to pass. I repent for not thinking that you can do this for me. I repent for not believing your ultimate power, that you are mighty to save. I repent for not praying. I repent, oh God, for believing that I can do it by myself and I didn't pray about it. And I made bad decisions for me. Lord, we repent, oh God. We repent for not seeking information, the right information. We repent for not paying our tithe. We repent, oh God, for not writing out the plan and making it plain. We repent for just kind of living our life as though we don't have a purpose or we don't have a reason for existence, just kind of living anyhow. We repent, oh God, for reckless living. We repent, oh God. We repent, oh God, for not staying focused, for being tossed to and fro, trying to follow the trends and what everybody is doing. We want to run and go do it also, but not staying on what you've called us to do. We repent for being so easily distracted, even when you're calling us to say, come, stay focused. We're like, yeah, we want to do this and that and that and that. We repent, oh God. Lord, we repent, oh God. We repent, oh God, as a church, we repent. Say, if we repent, if we confess our sins, you're faithful and you're just to forgive us and to cleanse us. Lord, we repent today in the name of Jesus. Father, help us to begin to do things your way, to begin to follow in the kingdom principle so that we can get results. We can get tangible results, oh God. Father, we, oh God, ask, oh God, that you will lead us by your Spirit, that you will help us to do that which only pleases you, that everything you say that we should do, we will do. Holy Spirit, please help us. We confess our sins and we ask for your help in the name of Jesus. Father, we thank you and we bless your name today and we give you all the glory and all the praise. Thank you so much, Lord. For in Jesus' name, amen. Can you give God praise this morning or this afternoon? Let's give him praise.
Hallelujah. Thank God for that word. And may the Lord bless us. And may we be partakers of that word in Jesus' name. Turn your Bibles to the book of Genesis. No, I'm kidding. I wasn't going to start preaching again. Praise God. Let's rise up as we close the service. Amen. Let's give God thanks and praise this afternoon for his word. Let's thank him for everything we have received of the Lord. Father, thank you. And blessed be your name. Thank you for all you've heard today. Thank you. Because we are going to go ahead and plan regardless of our bank accounts. Regardless of the people around us, regardless of the situations that we are confronted with, thank you because we are going to gather wise counselors to plan, and you will do great things with the plans you have laid in our hearts. And the year 2025 shall be great for us. We give you all the praise and glory in Jesus' mighty name. Can you speak to every day of this week? Just declare in advance that this week will be a good week for you and for me. It shall be a week of testimonies. It shall be a week of miracle signs and wonders. It shall be a week of breakthroughs. It shall be a week of advancement, a week of increase in the name of Jesus Christ. I decree every day of this week are the days the Lord has made. Therefore, me and my family, we shall rejoice and be glad in it. And so shall it be in Jesus' mighty name we've prayed. As you have decreed, so shall it be for you. Every day of this week are the days the Lord has made. Therefore, every one of us, we shall rejoice and be glad in them. In Jesus' mighty name, we have prayed. Amen. Let's share the grace together in fellowship from the book of 2 Corinthians 13, verse 14. 1, 2, ready, go. The grace of the Lord Jesus Christ and the love of God and the communion of the Holy Ghost be with us all. Amen. And surely, goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. Amen. God bless you. Please don't forget we're hanging out together on Friday at 6:30 p.m. at the bowling alley. The address was displayed. Let's be there 6:30 to 8:30 p.m. God bless you in Jesus' name. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah.
We thank you for listening to today's message. We know you have been blessed. So for more of these messages, please visit us on our website at www.thola.org and subscribe to our YouTube channel at THOLA TV. You can also follow us on Facebook, Instagram, and Twitter at THOLA_church. God bless you and keep on shining.